non-concave entropies and also about
recording in progress.
How this is at the origin of ensemble in equivalence, and I just had a slide on this microcanonical solution of the Blume-Capelle model. I remind you the Blume-Capelle model is a model of spin one, there is a Curie-Weiss coupling all to all with Katz rescaling in order to make the Curie-Weiss term extensive in N, and then there is a local term which goes like SI square. Okay, so and delta is a positive coupling parameter to SI square, which of course is ineffective if SI is equal to zero, but gives a positive contribution is if SI is either plus or minus one. How to count the states of this model? You take, for instance, typical configuration, which is a configuration of pluses, minuses, and zeros, and you can swap the spins, all the spins, and this gives an n factorial for the permutation of the spins. But then, of course, you get the same configuration if you swap the pluses, if you swap the zeros, and if you swap the minuses. So you have to divide by the by this. This is very similar to how you count states in, for instance, in the Ising model, or let's say even how you count the result of a coin toss experiment, you know, where there are pluses and minuses or head and tails, and you have a throw of, say, n throws, and you want to know in how many ways you realize that throw, and this will be n factorial divided the number of tails and the factorial and the number of heads factorial. It's the same binomial type. This is trinomial, because there are three states distribution. Then what you do, you express, so you use the Stirling approximation, so which says that log n factorial is n log n minus n. It's only the leading order of the Stirling approximation, as Matteo was mentioning yesterday. It's enough for this case. And then you take KB log omega, and what you get is this very complicated expression. You can check that when Q equals zero, you get back the sort of Curie-Weiss type of entropy, but if it's not, it's a more complicated. One aspect which is important, you will see in later on, is that you see that there are logarithms of quantities that can be negative. So of course, that loses any meaning, and you will see that this is very important for a phenomenon that I've not mentioned, and it's ergodicity breaking. I will do a comment on this in this case. And then another a relation which is important, if you go back to the energy of the model, you see that the energy is delta times some SI square, which is this Q parameter, which is called the quadrupolar moment, okay? Because it's clear that the quadrupolar moments, which counts the number of pluses plus the number of minuses, is a maximal when all are pluses or all are minuses. Okay, so Q measures the percentage of pluses. So you see that the energy divided by n can be written as delta times Q, and then if you factor delta with respect to Q also in the second term, which is Km square, is the usual Curie-Weiss term, Km square, K is J over 2 delta, okay? So why we want to factor delta, it will be clear later on, because by changing K, which is the ratio of Q and M, if you want, the relative ratio of Q and M, you will go from first order to second order phase transition by keeping delta constant. So it's a way of crossing the phase transition in a controllable way, okay, varying one parameter, only k. Okay, so this is entropy as a function of the quadrupolar moment and of the magnetization. Okay, it's a function of two quantities. So what you have to do, and it's sort of lengthy, you can do it as an exercise. I didn't put it on the slides. You can express the one of the two, for instance, Q, as a function of the energy and of the magnetization. You just invert the relation epsilon equal delta or Q minus Km square. You write epsilon over delta. Q is epsilon over delta plus Km square. And you substitute Q in all the terms of where Q appears in the entropy, okay? Then, in this way, you get an entropy, which is a function of energy per particle, energy per spin, and magnetization, okay? It's a more complicated expression. I have not written it down, okay? Just simply replace Q for epsilon over delta plus Km square. Okay, in this expression. And you get an expression which is S of epsilon and M, okay? So this is, if you want, is the equivalent of the Landau entropy, of the Landau free energy in the context of the microcanonical ensemble, because you are writing the entropy, like you write the Landau free energy, as a function, in the case of the Landau free energy, as a function of beta, of the inverse temperature, and of the order parameter, M, and in this case, you are writing the entropy as a function of the energy, which is not beta. You know that energy and beta are related by the Legendre transform one to each other. So you have now an entropy as a function of epsilon and the order parameter. This is already an interesting quantity, but it contains a lot of information, and I want to cancel a little bit of this information by taking the maximum of this entropy with respect to M. And this will give you the entropy as a function only of energy, okay? So, and how is the entropy as a function only of energy in this model? You can try to draw it. So if you have I suggest that you do a sort of plot, okay? I can tell you how more or less it is, okay? But then you will check. Okay, if you try to draw this entropy as a function of epsilon, okay, it will be something like this, okay, as a function of epsilon. So it results, as I've said, from substituting Q, okay, in this expression for epsilon and M, and then maximizing with respect to M. So if you don't want to spend too much time in coding, maximizing, you just sample M between minus 1 and 1, or between 0 and 1 will be the same because the expression is symmetric in M, and you take the maximal value. So you know how to write a code, you do it. Okay, if I encounter a value, I start from some value, okay, which is my maximum. If I encounter a value which is even larger, I take this new value and then I sample all the values of M. I take, let's say, 1,000 values of M, and then I get this entropy. So for us, when I first draw this, it was very deceiving because we were looking for ensemble in equivalence for non-concave entropies, and what we got was a sort of a graph that was perfectly concave. So I went to bed that night. I was very deceived. It was 20 years ago. So we were looking for non-concave entropies. And then the morning after, I went back to this curve, and I tried to zoom a part of it. And at some point appears on the screen a sort of darker part that was very, very small. You will see that the numbers are really small. And so that's where it was hidden, the non-concavity. So as usual, when you take a model at random and you look for something, if you are lucky, it can be the right model. If it's not, if you are not lucky, it can be in some, this is a story that I tell to everybody, so don't be deceived if it seems that everything goes wrong. So insist, if you are convinced that there is something, you should insist. Okay, this is the story, but I ask you to repeat this and to zoom. So first of all, another important feature that I was telling is the fact that you have in fact negative temperature here, okay, which is expected if if you go towards higher energies, the number of states goes down, and so you get negative temperature. You are in the part of positive temperatures, and here you get a non-concave part. Now, but I have to tell you how it works. So you see that the numbers here are really, really small. So point, so you see my parameter, delta over j, is I'm varying by very small quantities, delta over j. As I've told you, k is j over delta, is my my parameter, and what I'm plotting here is maybe I need the okay. Okay, so what I'm plotting here is already some it contains already some information on the phase transition, is the relation between the temperature and the energy. Okay, so I am computing beta through the microcanonical temperature, so now beta is ds dE, okay? And T is 1 over beta. And what I'm varying delta over J in order to cross the the canonical tricritical point. I remember to you that the phase diagram is something like this. This is here T over J. And there is here delta over j, delta over j. And I have a tricritical point here. This is second order phase transition. This is first order phase transition. And what I'm doing in this plot, I'm crossing this line with straight lines. Crossing the phase transition line with straight lines. You see that I have the parameter is delta over j, in such a way to reach the tricritical point. Okay, and the tricritical point is delta over j equal log 4 over 3. You remember from the yesterday. And what happens at the tricritical point, you see that you can prove it, but okay, it's clear from the graph that the slope here is zero. So this is typical of tricriticality, that the derivative of the temperature with respect to energy, which is the inverse of the specific heat, is infinite at the tricritical point. Okay, so and then what happens? It happens if you cross the tricritical point and you enter the first order phase transition region, then you see that the temperature goes down. You see that the numbers here are very small. So that's why so temperature goes down. I will try to draw now the entropy. I cannot do it because it's so small, the region, that I would have to zoom in very small numbers, but I will make you a drawing. But it's clear from what happens here that there is a region of negative specific heat, because if you go up in energy, temperature goes down. So here, on top, okay, and then it goes down, okay? So there is a region of negative specific heat. So it's not self-gravitating system, it's not plasmas, where it's not vortices, it's an extremely simple model, spin model, and it can be solved exactly, and it gives you a negative specific heat. So negative specific heat is not due to any other feature that were present in such systems, like singularities at short distances, collapse, non-equilibrium. We are perfectly at equilibrium. We are drawing the entropy of this system, and we discover that there is a negative specific heat. Okay, and then the relation here is continuous at some point. And what happens in the canonical ensemble? In the canonical ensemble, you rather draw, fix the temperature, no? So you go along this axis here. You start from low temperature, you increase the temperature, and as you increase the temperature, the average energy will go through this curve until you meet this point, okay? And at this point, you see there is a slight dotted line here, is the Maxwell construction. And then you jump to this value of the energy. And then you again, you start. So this is drawing the average energy as a function of the temperature, okay? So while in the canonical in the microcanonical ensemble, you have a system where there is no phase transition, okay, because there is a continuous relation between T and epsilon. In the canonical ensemble, you have a first order phase transition, okay? So the two ensembles don't give equivalent results. So one ensemble gives you a continuous curve, a continuous relation between temperature and energy, and the other ensemble gives you a first order phase transition, so that the two ensembles are not equivalent. So this was the first example of inequivalence ensembles. Maybe I can quote the paper. It's a paper in PRL in 2001 that started a long story of a study of systems with long-range interactions that give inequivalent ensembles. So in order to get inequivalence, you have to break some principle of additivity. This model, as I've told, has a Curie-Weiss term, which gives a non-additive energy. And this is the origin of the inequivalence of ensembles. And if you go on, okay, and you go from 4, 6, 2, 2, 6, 5, you go smaller, and you see that this becomes steeper and steeper, and at some point, this branch becomes vertical, and at this point, there is a discontinuity that we have called the microcanonical first-order transition because there is a jump in temperature at a given energy. And if I go on, the region of negative specific heat disappears, and I have only the jump. And finally, delta equal J equal 1/2, this point, I get a continuous relation between energy and temperature. This is a full phase diagram for this model. It's okay. Are there questions? I will try to draw now the entropy since.
There is a question from Zoom. So let me read it. So. Can something be done about the marker? Ah, okay. We don't see Rufo's pointer on Zoom. Okay.
Ah, the pointer. Yes, it's true. Yes. I can point like this. In this way, they see.
Okay.
Okay, I will do it with my finger. It's better. That was the question. Okay. 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 Okay, just I will draw the entropy for this case, which is the most complete one. There is a jump, there is negative specific heat. So what happens for the entropy? Suppose I would like to draw this entropy, okay, as a function of epsilon. In fact, when I do the maximum, I will discover that the maximum is satisfied by two branches. This is the M equals zero branch, and it's valid at high energy. And then there is an M different from zero branch here. And this branch also is convex, is concave. But then at some point, it starts to bend and becomes convex, okay? And then it touches this branch here. So here the derivative, which is the temperature, is not the same as here. So the two derivatives are not the same, and this gives the jump here, the jump in temperature, the jump in temperature. This region where the temperature decreases with the energy is the is this region here. Is this region here where the convexity is up? Okay, and this gives the region where temperature decreases when one increases the energy, and this is the region where with concave entropy, which gives the growing temperature with energy region, okay? So this is, and then of course, at some point, this will go down, okay? Okay, and okay, this region is here, was this little dot in my curve, because you see that the numbers are very close to each other. And so you have to really zoom in this region. Now, there are other models in which this part is larger. So I have chosen this one because historically it's the simplest one, and there are, but there are others in which the differences are order one. So it's easier to see this, this region. This depends on the model, on the parameters. Okay, so this is essentially, okay, so what I can do, if I want to be quantitative, and I suggest that you try this, so I expand the entropy as a function of M, okay? This is the constant term. This is the term proportional to M squared. The entropy, is, you can check, is symmetric in M. This is the term in front of M square, and this is the term in front of M4. You can try to derive them. Okay, do the exercise. It's a Taylor series expansion. It's not too heavy. And then you can check if you have done the exercise of yesterday of computing the free energy of this model. You can check that the condition of criticality, so the critical line in the canonical ensemble, is the same as the critical line in the microcanonical ensemble. So if you take this A and you put it at zero, and then you express the energy in terms of the temperature, you will find the critical line that you had found yesterday solving the model in the canonical ensemble. While the condition for tricriticality is not the same. So the condition for A and B to be zero is not the same. And gives two different tricritical points. So what happens in this region of the, you see that the numbers are very close, but I will expand. So what happens in this region is that you have the second order line, and you reach the canonical tricritical point, okay? Then the black line is the continuation with the first order critical line in the canonical ensemble. In the microcanonical ensemble, the critical line continues, okay? You see this dashed curve here. The critical line continues to reach the microcanonical tricritical point, is the point in which at some point, at a given energy, there is a temperature jump. So the plot of temperatures versus energies opens up, and you get a jump in temperature. This is this point. At this point, since there is a jump in temperature, there is an upper temperature and there is a lower temperature. So I have to follow the value of the upper temperature, which is this one, and the value of the lower temperature. Okay? So, and the two join when delta over J is on the T equals zero line. Okay? Okay. So if you want, the phenomenon of temperature jump in the microcanonical ensemble is nothing but the phenomenon of energy jump in the canonical ensemble. In the canonical ensemble is the dual of that phenomenon. So in the canonical ensemble, at a given temperature, I have a jump in energy and the latent heat. And in the microcanonical ensemble, at a given energy, I have a jump in temperature, which is, if you want to call it, a latent temperature. You're not used to this term, okay? But it's exactly the same thing. It's a bit less, I mean, you are not used to the fact that temperature can be discontinuous. And in fact, that was a mystery for us, and we went around telling this story. People were not convinced. How can it be that at a given energy, you have a system that has two temperatures? Is the system out of equilibrium? Because, I mean, at some point it should reach the same temperature. But you should consider that in the microcanonical ensemble, temperature is a derived quantity. It's not, temperature is the derived quantity. It's not the parameter that you vary with continuity. So, and in fact, finally, we have done also a study of this phenomenon, even numerically, to convince ourselves to see what happens. For instance, we have considered a system, I will not show it to you, with a kinetic energy, just to have a direct access to temperature. And what we have discovered is that at this point where the temperature jump appears, the probability distribution of the temperature is bimodal. So in some sense that the system is swapping from one temperature to the other temperature, and the distribution is bimodal. So the kinetic energy is bimodal at this point. It's interesting because in some simulations of self-gravitating systems, people have observed the same phenomenon, that the system is swapping in two different regions of kinetic energy, from the high kinetic energy to smaller kinetic energy, which is exactly the same phenomenon that we observe in these simple models. So these are simulations done in the group of Scott Tremain in Princeton. Is a self-gravitating system. They discovered also in self-gravitating system this. This led me during the years, so now I don't want to speak too much about that, to interact with these guys in self-gravitating system area. And there was a very interesting period of cross-fertilization where we were trying to classify what we were observing in these simple models and to find the equivalent in the self-gravitating system case. In particular, I did this together with Pierre-Henri Chavanis from Toulouse, who is an expert in self-gravitating systems. And it was very interesting because, for instance, they didn't have the same names, the different transitions that they were observing. So they were calling, I call it tricritical, he was calling it differently because they were finding the thing. It was very, very nice period where we have written papers together. Okay, just to give you a graph for the complexity. I don't want you to understand all this, okay? But this is a classification that was done by Julien Barré, who was my PhD student, and Freddy Boucher in a paper published in JSTATFIS using Arnold singularity theory. They were able to classify all, this is codimension one singularity, so codimension one means you vary only one parameter. And these are the shapes of entropies, and these are the shapes of inverse energy with respect to temperature. Some of them you have seen in my plot. Unfortunately, it seems inverse energy, and the different cases you can have. Okay, so the different shapes of entropies and what happens at the phase transition with the entropy. What I can tell you that several years later, so the point is that this is classification, so based on singularities, types of singularities that can happen in these. So these are functions, okay? S equal KB log QM and so on, okay? So you know, in mathematics, you can put question, what happens if I vary a parameter in this function, okay? Where is the maximum, where is the minimum, and so on. This is the type of questions, okay? And these questions are solved in a field which is called singularity theory. Okay, and they worked together with a mathematician, and they found a classification for some. So that, but then you don't have the model, so you have the what can happen, but you don't have the physical model where this happens. So we have tried by going around to find if there are these singularities. And I can tell you that I found, other people found different ones. I found this one, azeotropy, in a model. And it's very interesting because physically, azeotropy, you find azeotropy in binary mixtures. You take the book of Landau, and if you are patient enough, you reach a certain chapter, 10 or 11, I don't remember. There is a chapter on binary fluids, which where they discusses different phase transitions in binary and ternary fluids. And for binary fluids, there is a case where there is a reentrance in the canonical ensemble. Reentrance means that you vary the temperature, you enter a phase, and then you continue to increase the temperature, and you go back to the phase where you were at lower temperature. It's a bit strange, no? So suppose I have water, okay? I increase the temperature, I go to gas. Then I increase the temperature, I go back to fluid. It's very strange, okay? It's called reentrance. But in binary fluids, you can have this reentrance in the canonical ensemble, so at fixed temperature. What we have found is that if you go to the microcanonical ensemble, and this is codimension one perturbation, I have two solutions for this case with two entropies that are both concave, and then when I vary this single parameter, it's not temperature, I move the entropy, which is below up, until it crosses the other, okay, in the microcanonical ensemble. And so you get two first-order phase transitions, no? Because here you have two slopes, okay? One slope here and one slope there. So when you observe reentrance in the canonical ensemble, we observe azeotropy in the microcanonical ensemble. So it's a sort of strange behavior, and of course one can amuse oneself to find other cases in different models and to check ensemble inequivalence in various different models. I put this slide just to give you an idea where the field has gone. And for instance, last year we have published a paper with David Mukamel and on fourth order critical points and what is the phase diagram in the canonical and microcanonical at fourth order critical points. Fourth order critical points are points where B, A was zero, B is zero at three criticality, C is zero, so can happen, but you have to play with parameters more carefully. I don't want to enter in this part because it's a very complicated phase diagrams with it's not something that it, but it gives, of course, this type of procedure can give rise to many interesting physics and study of different situations.
So there is a question, what does invisible concavification signify? Does it mean entropy concavity does not exist?
In this honestly, invisible means that these are metastable branches that are not seen if you maximize the entropy. So they are invisible. They could correspond to metastable states, for instance, and unstable states. And they are almost invisible. I don't know how they could see it, but they are below the maximum of entropy. But you can reach those branches by metastability. The paper is published in JSTATFIS, I don't remember when, around 2010 maybe. I can give you the reference for that paper to the person who is asking. Okay. Okay, so what we have learned from this first lecture, so this is the end of the first lecture, so this is the material that I had prepared for the first lecture. We are at the third, unfortunately, so I was a bit slower. So the thermodynamic limit of long-range interactions is well-defined, provided the interaction is rescaled using the Katz factor. Thermodynamic formulas can be adapted to allocate long-range interactions through the Legendre-Fenchel transform for non-concave functions, which is an extension of a non-concave function theory. Ensembles are not necessarily equivalent. They can be equivalent, but they are not necessarily equivalent. Phase diagrams differ in canonical and microcanonical ensembles, but you can have similar non-equivalences, and we have found them between constant pressure ensembles and constant volume ensembles from grand canonical and canonical. We have examples that this happens when passing from one ensemble to the other. So I will give you a plot of the different ensembles at some point. And the entropy can be non-concave and specific heat and other response functions. You will see that also susceptibility can become. And this finishes the first lecture. Okay, so now I will stop sharing. And I will share the file of the second lecture. So 5 minutes to introduce the second lecture, and then you will get a break. Now it doesn't work. Yes, okay. Ah, yes, because I didn't go full screen. Okay. Okay, so just a brief now plan of the second part of the third lecture. And then I think it's time to have a break. So I will consider, and I will go now out of the regime of, because what we have seen is in this model there are all-to-all interactions and local interactions. So in order to find models in which short-range interaction can compete with long-range interactions, with all-to-all interactions, we get back to this model. It was introduced by Nagel and Kardar in the 80s. And we have solved this model in the microcanonical ensemble, and we find similar phase diagram. This is just to be sure that when you add nearest neighbor interaction, the system, the ensemble in equivalence is stable in some sense. So you continue to find ensemble in equivalence. Then I will discuss ergodicity breaking and method stability. And I will introduce a method which allows to solve the microcanonical ensemble without counting. So this is another path of solvable models. Of course, counting is the best way to solve entropy, but there are systems for which you cannot count because the phase space variables are continuous or because you are unable to count. So this method allows to solve the microcanonical to get non-concave entropies. And then I will apply the method, if I can, maybe this will go to tomorrow, to a model which is in the class of the Nagel-Cardar. And then, okay, I will give you, I will let you solve the Nagel-Cardar method using the transfer matrix. Okay, this is the plan. Okay, so maybe 5 minutes to introduce the model. So the model is now a spin 1/2 model, spin 1/2 model, with the usual Q-revised term here. And plus, I add in one dimension, this is a constant here, you can forget about it, it's constant, with a coupling K, and there is a coupling, a nearest neighbor coupling. The solution of the model in the canonical ensemble was done by Nagel and Cardar. It's simple. You just, as we did for the other model, you just express the Q-revised term using the Hubbard-Sartanovich. And then what you get, this is what you should do as an exercise, okay? So what you get an effective partition sum, which has this form, is the integral over the auxiliary field of the Hubbard-Sartanovich as usual. So there is an x beta si here, and then there is a minus k with a j, the j to n and others. Okay, there are constants. Okay, and then you have a k si plus one. And this is the Ising model in an external field, okay? And the external field contains the auxiliary field. So you solve the Ising model in the external field using transfer matrix, take the logarithm of the largest eigenvalue in the transfer matrix. And so you express these the eigenvalues in terms of x. And then you maximize in x. And then you maximize, there is an exponential here, of course. And then you maximize in x, okay? And if you maximize in x, you get the partition sum okay, so maybe the counting is for the next, I don't know, are you tired that we can go on or not? It's okay, we can go on? Because we had quite a long break, so. Or you want 5 minutes of rest? 5 minutes, okay. Okay, 5 minutes of rest. Visto che scriva su Slack c'è poca interazione alla fine. Io ho messo le slides.
Sì.